Hey there, and welcome to this special episode of Chet Chat, where we've brought you into Bangalore, into the office of Great Learning, to meet with the Director of New Product Development, Harish Subramanian. And we're going to do this video specially for you, and you're going to watch right till the end, because you've been asking me to tell you everything about artificial intelligence and machine learning. And today we're going to tell you the difference between the two. We're going to talk about career opportunities, study opportunities, and especially for all you non-programmers who get really worried saying, is this a field that I can get into because I don't have any programming experience? Today's video is going to tell you all those little secrets that are going to make you successful in this field. But before we get Harish to join us on the show, please remember to press that subscribe button and the bell icon right next to it to get your notifications every time we go online. And don't forget to like us at Facebook, at Instagram, and Twitter at ChetChat101. So Harish, welcome to ChetChat, and thank you so much for the
Happy
time.
To be here.
You know, this is a heavily requested video. Okay. They're all so curious about this beautiful new space about artificial intelligence, machine learning, data science. They don't know which one to pick and why. So tell us first off, what is AI, artificial intelligence, and ML, machine learning? What are they and what are the differences between them?
Well, I'll correct one thing you said there. Right? So this is, it's new only in the sense that we're using it very widely now. But this whole field has been around for decades. I think what's changed is just the level of computing power we have. You know, the technological advancement has allowed us to start using this everywhere.
Right.
Building this kind of technology into our apps, into some of us might have seen Amazon Alexa at home or something like that. That is new.
Right. So now the impact is more.
Yeah. So let's just unpack this area a little bit, right? So artificial intelligence as a space is largely the idea of getting machines or computers to do what we do as human. You know, we look at something or we hear something, and then based on whatever we're seeing, we perceive something. Then we're processing it.
Right.
We're applying our intelligence. We're reasoning. We're thinking through an issue. Is this something that I should be afraid of, or is this benign?
Right.
We're applying all of that reasoning, and then we have an action based on it.
Right.
Now, take all of that and get a machine to do it. That, in a nutshell, is what artificial intelligence is all about. But how do you go about applying all of this reasoning? That's the stuff that machine learning is all about.
Right.
So machine learning is largely just a subset of artificial intelligence. It's a way that machines can learn to reason like we do. They're taking a lot of input. Again, the input can be in any form, right? It could be bank transactions, it could be e-commerce transactions, it could be images, video, sound, speech, whatever it is.
Right.
And we're taking all of that, we're processing it, and then, you know, based on that, we're making some kind of a prediction.
Okay.
Right? This is a fraudulent transaction, this is not.
Right.
Or it's going to rain today or it's not. And that, you know, the machinery behind it, the technique, the mathematical and computing techniques we apply to do that, that's machine learning.
Right.
Quite often when people say artificial intelligence, they mean machine learning.
Yeah.
They're not vastly different areas, right? One is just a subset of the other. And one other thing that people talk about a lot is they talk about artificial intelligence being, you know, this kind of sentient robots that are coming to get us. Right?
Invade the planet.
We're far from that. We're really far from
that.
That's what's called general AI or strong AI. Now, we're still at the stage where we're getting machines to do one single thing very well.
Right.
So if you take, for example, Facebook, the little box that it puts around you when you upload an image.
Right.
That's just detection. It's just saying there is a person there and that person is likely this person. That's a very singular thing. Right? Now, if you get that same algorithm, that same machine learning technique to do something else, like get a robot to walk, it can't do it.
Right.
Because that kind of knowledge or learning doesn't transfer. Like even infants.
Right.
Infant humans can, like little one-year-olds and two-year-olds learn at a much faster rate than machines can.
Yeah, you say apple, he says apple, and you teach a computer to recognize an apple could take a longer time.
And then they'll, like for example, they might see an image of an apple, or, you know, a two-dimensional picture in a book.
And still
then they see
know,
a real apple, and they still know that this
connect,
is that.
Yes.
Machines can't do that yet.
Right.
So, or some machines can, but we're still at that very, very early stage.
And like you're saying, it's interesting because it's also about getting the machine perhaps to improve upon itself and the learning over a period of time. So it'll it'll get there at some point.
But even that, right? So the more information you give it, the more examples of something that it sees, the better it gets at recognizing and distinguishing between things and so on. So but it's still just that one thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so to set the scene, we are pretty good at recognizing images.
Right.
So if you see a picture, even among a crowd of somebody you know, chances are you'll probably spot them and spot the right person and tag them and identify them correctly. Right. So humans are at about 95-97% of accuracy when we do that.
Right.
As recently as 2012, machines were at about 78%. That has now surpassed human levels of image recognition.
Wow. Right?
So Facebook or Google tagging a picture, and regardless of whether it's dark, it's obscured, it's only half able to see you, whatever it is, the tagging technology has now reached an accuracy well beyond humans, right? So it's above 98%. It's coming up on 99%.
Wow.
And that's surpassed us. And that's just happened in the last 4 or 5 years. And that's where a lot of that has to do with, you know, deep learning and some of these other techniques that we've come up with. But it's also just one of the secrets of AI that nobody talks about is just that now every one of us is taking a million pictures a year.
Yes.
Right? We're taking all of these pictures.
That's input. You're constantly providing fresh data.
You're feeding all of this data into the machine. So you could have the most sophisticated algorithm, but if you don't feed it a lot of data, and in our case, that's what in machine learning parlance, they call label data, right? We're feeding data where we have tagged ourselves, we put our names.
Yeah.
That's all learning.
Right?
That's all information that it's learning from. It's able to absorb and do all of that.
So Harish, tell me, there are students watching this and they're very interested and they're excited already by what you're showing them as possibilities that they can have. But these are high school students perhaps or undergrads who are not typically technology undergrads, or they are not computer science conversant children. So how do you think, or do you think they can still have a career in artificial intelligence, machine learning areas?
Look, so there are two ways of thinking about this, right? So one is that, like, we don't say you have a career in using a computer.
Right.
Because now everybody does.
Right.
And from whether you're a 2-year-old kid or an old person, right? Everybody uses a computer, everybody uses a smartphone. That wasn't the case in 1995.
Absolutely.
Right? And then, you know,
suddenly the question is never asked anymore.
10 years later, it was a very strange question to ask, right? Everybody used it. And AI and machine learning are a little bit in that, in the same, at that point of their kind of trajectory of growth. So 10, 15 years from now, I don't know the exact time, but everything will have
encompassed.
Will have machine learning built into it and all of that, right? So then having a career in machine learning doesn't really mean having a career in machine learning. It could be, you know, you would be a marketer, you would be a finance person, you could be
social scientist,
you could be you could be running a restaurant and you will have machine learning. OpenTable is a company that based in the US that sort of provides this software platform for people to book tables through, I guess, the way we do in Zomato and all of that stuff, and you book tables, but they're starting to build machine learning into that.
Right.
Because it's starting to say, you know, can I offer, how much waiting time can I offer to the person based on the traffic that I've seen in the past, based on the number of tables I have, you know, is this a holiday, is this not a holiday, and so on and so forth, right? Now, if you're running a restaurant, you need to know this, right? You need to know that such things exist. If you're a banker, you need to know these things. From that perspective, a career in machine learning is no longer a career in machine learning. It's a career in whatever you need to do. So you need to know how this is going to impact you and affect you. So that's one dimension, The other dimension is that, as with any other technology, it first starts with being, you know, uber geeky, right? And only the most hardcore programmers, you know, who write code all day can work with it. And then it starts to become more user friendly.
Right.
So basically, what's going to happen with a lot of this is that things are going to start getting a lot more commoditized. It's going to get productized.
Right.
And when it gets productized, what ends up happening is that it's no longer about the underlying technology.
Right.
It's no longer about the how. It's what do you want to do with it. Right? And that's where a lot of people have careers. So if you want to build a product, right, and your product is, you know, security cameras, whatever it is, right? Now, if you were to do it in the old way or the traditional way and you wanted to apply machine learning to it or AI to it, you need to apply a lot of code to it. Right? But now you have tools for this. Other people have done this for us. So now you can just take that tool, you still need to know what it does and at least broadly how it works. And that's where the non-technology folks and the non-technical people still have to have some understanding, an understanding of what does it do and how, and then you just apply it.
So let's talk about, this is very fascinating that almost everyone should be part of this and can be part of this. But just to understand, what could you give us examples on what the careers might look like if they were to get into it as non-programmers?
Yeah. The first wave of this is going to be people who are building things. You could be a product manager. You could be, you know, again, a marketer. You could be, you know, somebody on the business side of things. Mm. And then there are obviously offshoots of this, right? So for anybody, let's say you're a salesperson, right? Chances are you're going to sell a product that uses this in some way.
Right.
Now, if you understand at a very fundamental level what AI is and how it gets baked into a product, you're better able to sell your product. It could be anything. It could be a matrimony site, right? If I'm better at matching two people, you know, I'm going to get more business.
Absolutely.
Right? I don't need to know how it's doing more. I need to understand that it can do more. And I need to understand that tool X or product X helps me build a better matching system compared to product Y.
Okay.
And, you know, and I need to understand where all this fits into my business.
Okay. So this is interesting. You're talking about the whole set of tools that are available. You're talking about potential applications for it and being able to marry the two and figure out how your business can benefit from it. But the question that I have on mind is that how do they go about all this? How do they learn about all the tools that are available? Mm-hmm. Let's say they're in school, they're in undergrad. For example, they're doing a biology major right now or an economics major right now. And they're saying, okay, great, but what do I need to do next? Yeah. So what would you say?
With some very tactical tips, right? I would actually sign up for a few really interesting newsletters.
Okay.
Right? And the reason, so I'm a big fan of newsletters. And the reason I say newsletters in particular is because a lot of the ones that I'll get to in a moment actually merge application and the technology. Mm-hmm. Right? So they're not meant only for technical people. They're giving you a glimpse of what's coming down the road.
Okay.
Right. Now on the technical side of things, or for people who are willing to geek out a little bit more, you have things like O'Reilly's AI newsletter, right? Or O'Reilly's machine learning newsletter. MIT Review has a great newsletter. Wired Magazine has a great newsletter. And these are all free. Mm-hmm. So you literally just have to go to these places, sign up, and you get newsletters. The one thing I will say is initially it won't make sense. I think people have to give themselves that time. And this is always what I tell anybody who's reading any of these newsletters, which is start with reading it and trying to understand just at the highest level what's going on. It doesn't matter if you understand how and what and so on. Right? Just understand at the highest level. Because what this all of this allows you to do is start to see possibilities.
Right.
And then you can start digging a little deeper because all of those will have references and so on and so forth, and you get linked and so on and so forth. The other thing that I would urge everybody to do is, quote unquote, traditional media tends to not be very accurate about how things are working or what's happening.
Right, they're just more headline newsy.
So instead of that, you know,
the newsletter
kind of an approach makes a lot more sense.
Right.
And you know, related to that, a lot of the big companies, right? So if you take Google, if you take Facebook, if you take Nvidia, which makes all of these chips, right? And all of these companies, they put out very user-friendly, very layman-friendly introductions to all of these things.
Okay.
Right? So they've put out things in cartoon format. They've put out things as short videos. They've put explainer videos. They've put things like that, right? And I think that's another place to get started.
Okay.
Now, the first 6 months or so of this journey is largely just getting conversant with what people are talking about.
Right,
you may not understand any of this. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's the terminology, it's who are the important people that you should be following, what are the big companies in this space, what are the kind of possibilities people keep talking about. Right, you may not, again, understand any of the nitty-gritty, but this gets you a long way. You know, as with any new field, you're just setting your filter, right? You're saying, okay, there's a hose pipe of all of this stuff coming in. What is it that I want to consume? Mm. A second thing that goes with all of this is follow the things that you find interesting to read. And I think a lot of people make the mistake of buying fancy books and trying to consume things that are way beyond their current level of understanding. And then it's a step too far.
Right. And then they give up.
And then you give up or lose interest. Or you have a subscription to a service, but you don't really use it because it's too advanced for you. The final step that I always recommend to people is talk to people around you. But a lot of this will start to make sense through kind of collective learning.
Right?
So if you're in school, if you're in college, you know, set up an AI club, set up an AI group, right? Where you don't have to do anything formal. Maybe you just get together and discuss, you know, a set of 5 articles. Maybe you just talk about this cool new thing you read, or, you know, there was this really viral video of Boston Dynamics robot, you know, opening doors and running away, right? Maybe you just sit together and watch that. Maybe you, you know, get together and watch the movie AlphaGo. Any of this is fine. But that collective helps, right? Because that, I mean, let's think about where all of this technology comes from, right? It comes from Silicon Valley. Now, what does Silicon Valley have? It has a community of people. Right? It has people who are similarly interested. And when you're in that space and what seems like a daunting space, you start to realize that, hey, none of us really know this stuff. Right? That makes it a lot less daunting. Because I could say, hey, you know what, go talk to your professor, go talk to an expert. But that's a daunting prospect.
Right.
Instead, go talk to other people who are kind of interested
like
in this.
Like you.
But who don't know this either.
Right.
And together learn this.
And also sometimes meetups, do you think? Some cities have...
Now, meetups, yes, for sure. But I personally find that meetups have the largest variability in terms of quality.
Right.
You know, then there is the social awkwardness and there's a couple of these other things. So if you're an outgoing type of person, then yeah, meetups are great. In meetups, the biggest benefit is actually the community and talking to other people sitting around you rather than the talks themselves. So if you are the outgoing type of person and you like meeting other people, I think meetups are great, but be picky about which meetups you go to. The ones with a really wide audience with a large group of people and high attendance numbers tend to be good.
So Harish, that was really informative, you know, telling us about exactly what to look for, because there is a lot of information available on these topics. But you helped us sort of focus on where we need to. Now let's assume there is a student who's a non-programmer, non-mathematics student. And he's decided to go down the path you've suggested, read the material that you recommended, meet up with people, and he's sort of interested in the field broadly, but is still afraid of not being that domain specialist. So you suggested one route where they stick to their current jobs. Let's say they're in a marketing job, or they're in a finance job, or in an HR job, and they perhaps could add a new flavor to that job going forward, where the need for AI arises and they put up their hand and they say, I know everything about it, and they sort of become the leader of that project, and that could be a great way for them to grow within their existing setups. But let's for a moment look at them moving out of their existing setup. Let's look at companies that are specialized in AI and ML and those areas. Are there jobs and opportunities for these students who are not core specialists in that area, and what kind of opportunities you think they would be?
Yeah, in India, let's take the case of what's happening right now in India. So right now in India, there are two kinds of places where a lot of AI development is happening. One are some of the larger companies, right?
Okay.
So Amazon, for example, is building out a huge Alexa team in Hyderabad. And Microsoft, again, is prominent in Hyderabad and is building that out. And I'm sure Google's doing something similar. Now, they're hiring thousands of people. Now, guess what? They're going to have to find people who can recruit these people.
Yes.
Right? So on the recruiting and HR space, there's a whole set of jobs there.
Right.
Right? Because if you can't intelligently parse through somebody's resume or CV and tell if somebody actually knows what they're talking about, you're not very valuable to that team.
Right.
So similarly, once they've built all of this out, you're going to have salespeople, both business, say, B2B sales and consumer sales. Outside of these big companies, you'll also have similar kind of opportunities at smaller firms.
Right.
So there are a ton of these really small startups, a lot of them here in Bangalore, but also in Gurgaon, Hyderabad and Chennai, for example. And people are building out teams of 10, 20, 30 people. But these are very narrow solutions, right? So somebody might say, I'm building intelligent cloud systems. Who's the person who's going to sell that? Chances are they know nothing technical, but they know enough about cloud computing and enough about AI to be able to piece these together and make intelligent suggestions to customers. Ultimately, you'll have to bring a technical person with you, or later on connect them to somebody technical, but you're the one who's making that sale. So similarly, everyone who's trying to build out a team will need HR and people ops and recruiting and so on, all of these functions that are related to it. Right? So identifying some of these, the small startups and some of the AI departments at Walmart Labs, at Amazon, at Google, at Facebook, at Flipkart, and all of these places where you are focused on AI-related products, I think that's another good place to go.
Fantastic. I think that was wonderful. They're all sufficiently excited and enthusiastic. Good. And we're also going to be with you on the same topic for data scientists.
Yeah.
So you're going to watch out for that coming soon. But thank you so much, Harish, for being with us.
Happy to be here and happy to help.
Hey, so thank you for watching right till the end. But I still think you must have a lot of questions that you want to ask me or Harish. So put everything down in the comment section right under this video. And don't forget that subscribe button and the bell icon right next to it to get your notifications. And like us and subscribe to us at Facebook, Twitter and Instagram at ChetChat101. And happy watching.